Well, that was very good. Betty was playing, and some of you were joining in and humming along, and others were arriving, and some were talking. And it's kind of hard to break into that. You would just like to let that roll on for a few minutes. But then when it comes to the other end, you would blame me for it and not you. So then we have to get started, don't we? Well, a very warm welcome to you to our Good Friday evening service. We really appreciate you making the effort to come. And we have some visitors with us. So that's just excellent. You are very, very welcome indeed. And then you always have to be careful when you go to say we've got some old faces with us. You know you're sunk then, but it's nice to see Heather and Martha with us. And Martha hasn't been out for quite some time, being in hospital and recuperating. So that's just lovely to see you, and thank you for making the effort to come. And other visitors with us, you are all very, very welcome indeed. Those joining us online, also great to have you as well, and we trust that you will know the presence of the Lord as well. So it's good to be together on Good Friday, and just remember what the Lord has done for us. And sometimes when I come to Good Friday, I feel a bit like I feel coming to communion. Sometimes you really feel like, you know, like celebrating. Other times you feel like just being quiet and almost feel like weeping and just the solemnity of it. And when I come to Good Friday, I feel like that as well. There's one part of me wants to celebrate and praise the Lord for all he's done, and yet there's another part of me feels sorry for all that the Lord had to go through. And it's one of those gatherings where you feel that kind of mix of emotion. So maybe tonight we will come to celebrate and to worship, or maybe we've just come to remember and just pause for a moment or two and reflect. Maybe we have come to weep and confess. Maybe we've just come to humble ourselves or commit ourselves or recommit ourselves again to the Lord. But whatever it is, we're going to remember what the Lord has done for us on what we call Good Friday. Let me just read the first reading, and you'll find it in 1 Corinthians 15, and just the first four verses together. It says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preach to you, which also you received and in which you stand, by which also you were saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." But we're remembering that part there where it says that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Let me just read in the New Testament in Luke chapter 22, and then we're going to stand and sing. And this is just a little bit, the hymn we're going to sing is, "I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene," and it reflects this little portion of Scripture. So there's still some gathering with us, but we will read this and then stand to sing. "And Jesus, coming out of the upper room with the disciples, he went to the Mount of Olives as he was accustomed to doing, and his disciples also followed him. When he came to the place, he said to them, 'Pray that you may not enter into temptation.' And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, 'Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done.' Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. When he rose up from prayer and had come to his disciples, he found them sleeping from sorrow. Then he said to them, 'Why do you sleep? Rise and pray, lest you enter into temptation.'" A little brief prayer, and then we're going to sing. Father, we thank you for bringing us together tonight in order that we might worship you, that we might celebrate all that you have done for us, and Lord, that we might humble ourselves in your presence. And Lord, we ask your blessing upon this service, each one taking part, And Lord, we pray that your name will be glorified. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and sing this lovely, lovely hymn together. It's a great hymn to sing and appropriate for this evening. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. We know it well. There's a good number of us, and I'm sure we can really sing it, and do it justice. So let's stand to sing, please. Thank you. Please take your seats. That's good singing. In the first little portion of scripture we read together, it says that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. And I've been thinking about that according to the scriptures quite a little bit over these last few days. And I was saying to Sharon and asking, and I'm asking here as well, if all that you had was just the gospel accounts of the crucifixion of Jesus, would you pick up why he died? You would pick up how he died. You would pick up where he died. You would pick up who was involved in his death. But would you actually pick up and say that he died for me? So I kind of had that thought, and then I'm reading through all four gospel accounts and trying to work that out. But we do need the wider scriptures that actually tell us and show us and reveal to us why Christ died. So 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, I'll just read it, says, "Who himself," speaking of Jesus, "bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we might die to sins and that we might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed." Or also in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit." And there are other scriptures, and we will read one or two other places as we go through our service, that tell us that Christ died for our sins. And we're here tonight to remember that. We're here to reflect upon that. We're here to bring that to bear upon our own lives. And we're here to worship him for all that he has done for us. Now, we were meant to have the choir singing, but Brenda wasn't too sure if we had enough choir members. So Brenda has kindly volunteered to sing us. So, no, maybe Brenda's not going to sing a solo. I wouldn't think. But the piece that the choir was going to sing is "You're the Word of God the Father." And maybe we'll just keep our seats, and if you have that, Martin, on the screen, then we will all become the choir. You weren't expecting to join the choir when you came tonight, were you? Well, you're now part of the choir, and we'll just keep our seats and sing this together, please. Thank you. Amen. Isn't it amazing that the author of creation was prepared to leave heaven in the splendor and prepared to come to earth as a man, and not only to do that, but prepared to take our sins upon himself on a cross and be prepared to die for us. It is amazing what the Lord Jesus has done for us. Sharon was just reading this earlier, and then we were reading it together from Revelation chapter 5. And I'll just break into the chapter at verse 10, and it gives us a little insight into what they think about the Lord Jesus Christ even in heaven, as John has this vision into heaven in Revelation chapter 5 and verse 5. It says, "But one of the elders said to me," that's to John, "do not weep. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the scroll and to loose its seven seals. And I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne and of the living creatures, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as though it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. Then he came and took the scroll out of the right hand of him who sat upon the throne. Now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and the golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals. For you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory, blessing and honor and glory and power be to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb forever and ever." Then the four living creatures said, "Amen," and the 24 elders fell down and worshipped him who lives forever and ever. In heaven they worship the Lord. In heaven they bow before him, the elders, the angels. They worship the Lamb who was slain to redeem people out of every nation, every tongue, every tribe, every country. And one day when we're there in heaven, there'll be people from every nation in the world praising the Lord, worshiping him who died upon the throne. And we have come tonight to worship him, to hear about him, to praise him, to celebrate all that he's done. And I trust in your heart there is worship for him. Now, Brittany has very kindly agreed to sing for us, and I'm going to ask Brittany to come just now and sing a couple of pieces to us. Thank you.
The busy streets and sidewalks, they suddenly grew still as a to see him. There he taught of love and kindness. Yes, he brought a better way. As he spoke, they'd turn and whisper and they'd say, Jesus, Jesus, he is the Son of God. Jesus, Jesus, the precious Son of God. Sweetest rose of Sharon came to set us free. Jesus, Jesus, he's everything to me. Yes, he's all the world to me. Then the air grew cold and the sky turned black as they nailed him to a tree. There he died for country, but the price he paid and the blood he shed is changing lives today, and with joy and praise you can hear these people say, Jesus, Jesus, he is the Son of Jesus, the precious Son of God. Sweetest rose of Sharon came to set us free. Jesus, Jesus, he's everything to me. Yes, he's all. My joy.
Amen. Thank you very much, Brittany, for singing those lovely, lovely Easter pieces to us and just helping us to think and focus and to reflect. We really, really do appreciate that. Now, let me just read Isaiah 53 and just quietly move into that for now. And as we said at the beginning, according to the Scriptures, Christ died for our sins. Well, here's another Scripture written about 750 years before Jesus actually died, telling, foretelling, prophesying, revealing what would happen. So Isaiah 53:1 says, "Who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of dry ground. He has no form nor comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted." Verse 5 says this, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement or the punishment of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgressions of my people he was stricken. And they made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death, because he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him, and he has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he has poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sin of many, and he made intercession for the transgressors. Amen, and may the Lord bless to us the reading of Isaiah 54. Now, there are not very many notices, but again, just to give you a very, very warm welcome, thank you for coming, and we really do appreciate that. I did check with some of the deacons, and they assured me that there is some refreshments and tea and a few nice things to eat. And Richard said, oh, yes, he said, you should really see what's in the back yet. So I got the feeling from that there must be a good tea afterwards. So please, please wait with us if you can after for that. And my thanks to all those who've put work and effort into that in preparing that for us and sorting that out. That doesn't just happen. So thank you very much indeed for that. Then do remember, please, our services on Sunday morning, Easter Sunday, 11:30 in the morning, and then 6:30 in the evening. And we would ask you to please join with us if you can. And we look forward to that. A great day on Easter Sunday when we remember the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe some of you will be heading to some of the Easter conventions that are on, either Faith Mission down in Bangor starting tonight through until Tuesday night, or you're heading up to the North Coast, up to CEF. And their convention there in Port Rush. And we trust that these meetings will also know the blessing of the Lord over this weekend. Now, we're going to stand and sing again our next song together. How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Let's stand and sing and think about these lovely words, please. Thanks, Betty.
Thank you.
again, another lovely song reflecting on the truth of Easter and the truth of Good Friday. And the living hope, I'm sure, came from 1 Peter chapter 1, where it says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to His abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." And we have a living hope even in the face of death. Let's have a little prayer together, and then we want to think for a few moments about something from Isaiah 53, and then we'll sing again. Father, we just thank You for these songs that we've been singing and the songs that Brittany has been singing to us. Lord, we thank You for the truths of being able to just stand and sing together and proclaim about the death and the resurrection and the great salvation and all that You have done for us in dying for us. And we thank You that You paid the price in full, and thank You that You offered to us a full and free salvation with nothing to be added, nothing to be done. You have paid it all completely. Lord, we just thank You. And just, Lord, for a few moments as we think about something in Your Word, we ask, Lord, again for Your presence, and we ask for the help of the Holy Spirit. And we ask, Lord, that You will work out Your purposes. So we thank You in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Now, just for a few minutes, let me just talk a little bit about this portion, Isaiah 53. And to begin with, just to mention a couple of things about this being Good Friday. I don't know if you're ever the kind of person like me, and you look at a name like that or a title like that upon a day, and you say to yourself, why did they call it Good Friday? What was good about it that they gave it that name? And then you think for a moment and you say, well, Good Friday? Why did they call it Good Friday? Good Friday's the day when we remember that a man died. It's a day when we remember that it was injustice. It was a miscarriage of justice. And yet we call it Good Friday. It's a strange title, it would seem to me, in my kind of reflection. And yet that's what it is. But the word good, you know, words kind of change their meaning, don't they, from time to time and so on. And way back years ago, good had the idea of holy or pious. And I think that was the old meaning. It was a holy day. It was a good day. Therefore, it was Good Friday. Now, sometimes still it is called in other countries and places, it's called Holy Day. I think in Polish-Greek circles it can be called Great Friday. Other places it's Black Friday. Some places it's God's Friday. In some of the Nordic countries it's called Long Friday. In Germany it's called Morning Friday, or sometimes Silent Friday, like we get from at Christmas, Silent Night. So with all of these different words describing this particular day that we know as Good Friday. Then I was thinking about this, thinking, well, Good Friday, but sometimes my good days are other people's bad days. All right, so, you know, if you're playing some game and you win, it's good for you. And if somebody else loses, that's not a good day for them. Or if you're a football supporter and you're, you know, supporting, you know, some team and they win, oh, it's a great day for you. But if you happen to be supporting the losing team, it's not a good day for you. Or we love to talk about the weather in Ireland, some great weather we've been having recently. You know, well, I'll talk about the sunshine, you know. Maybe if it's hot sunshine, you know, and you're at the beach, you say that's a great day. But here in Ireland, we have such long spells of sunshine, you know, that the farmers and the gardeners are crying out for rain because it's too dry. So it can be a good day for you, and it can be somebody else's bad day. And we're talking about Good Friday. So what's Good Friday about? Why do we call it a good day, the day that Jesus came into the world, or at least the day that Jesus, who had come into the world, died upon the cross. Why is it good? Is it good for you? Or is it bad? So let's think a little bit around about that, about the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's think about Jesus. So Jesus comes into the world at Christmas. He comes in as a baby. We have celebrated that 3 or 4 months back. We sing about Emmanuel, God with us, fully man, fully God. He lived a perfect life. He never sinned. He never did anything that was wrong. He never said a wrong word. And he spent his whole life in doing good, healing people, helping people, calming storms, feeding hungry, even raising the dead. He spent his whole life in doing good. The Lord Jesus Christ, always doing good and always teaching truth. And yet the religious leaders got jealous of him, annoyed with him, and wanted rid of him. And it says in the portion in Isaiah that we read, it says that they despised him. That just means they mocked him, they shunned him, they scorned him, he was a vile person. Verse 3 says, and they rejected him. It means they left him alone. It just means he was someone unworthy of their company, someone who was unworthy of their conversation. They just left him in the corner, as it were. They didn't want anything to do with him. No, he's not in my company. It's not for me. The religious leader said, no, he's not part of our religious group, no. He's got nothing to offer to us. And yet he was perfect. Verse 3 says, and they did not esteem him. Now that's not a word we use very often really, but here's what it means. It's an accounting word. It means to reckon up and value. And we all do it all the time. All you who have bought a car, you have gone round kicking tires, haven't you, as we call it, you know? So what do you do in kicking tires, you know? Oh, I wonder, is that okay? And then you look at the other side of the car, oh, I wonder, is that okay? And then you look in at the miles and you say, oh, I wonder, are they genuine? Seems very low. And then you look to see if the paint works the same. What are you doing? You're esteeming its value. You're weighing it up and saying, is it worth it? Now, some of you ladies, you do it in a different way. You know, you go to the shop. So then you see some particular, you know, whatever, clothes. And you hold it up this way and that way. And then maybe upside down and then this way. And then in the mirror, you know. And then you leave it there. And then you do every other shop in the whole town. And then you come back to the first shop and you think maybe it might do. And then you bring it home and think, well, maybe I could return it. What are you actually doing? You're weighing up its value. How do I look in this? Will it suit me or not? You're esteeming its value. Will I pay that much? Is it okay? That's the word. And whenever those religious leaders and whenever the others there weighed up the value of Jesus, they said, he's of no value to me. I don't want him. He's not part of my company. He's got nothing to offer me. I don't want him. No value. No value on his name. No value on his life. No value on his death. No value on his words. No value on his promises. No value on his return. They considered no value. So they conspired together to get rid of him, along with the Roman political authorities, and they tried to get rid of him. And instead of Jesus, they chose a criminal and said, crucify him. I don't want him. He was of no value. And the day that Jesus died on the cross, the religious leaders thought it was a great day. We've got rid of him. But on the same day, at the same moment, his followers and disciples and his mother, it seemed a bad day.
You can read about them weeping, confused, scattered, denying him, disappointed. You can read about the disciples saying, oh, we thought he was the Messiah and Redeemer, but he's died. He's buried. And it's come to nothing. We thought he would be a great leader in our nation, but he's nothing. The day that Jesus died, for them it seemed like a bad day. Now let's think about this from God's perspective, God the Father. Jesus is the Messiah. He is God come on the flesh. What did God the Father think about this day? Well, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him wouldn't perish but have everlasting life. And God the Father sent his Son to die. Look at Isaiah 53:10. Here's what it says. It pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin. Now let's just park on that for a minute. It pleased the Lord. It pleased the Lord, the Father, to see him die. Maybe the version you're reading will say, and it was his plan. It was his will. It was his delight. It was his solution. The word bruised there means to be utterly crushed, to break in pieces, ending in death. Why did it please the Lord to bruise him? Because an offering for sin had been found. The Bible says the wages for sin is death. And Jesus, who had no sin of his own, took your sin and mine and died on the tree. And maybe I can't put it any better than the hymn puts it when it says, there is a green hill far away without the city wall where the dear Lord was crucified who died to save us all. There was no other good enough to pay the price of sin. He only could unlock the gate of heaven and let us in. And when the Father looked from heaven at the Son upon the cross, in a strange kind of way, not because he suffered, but because the Father knew a way for sin, a way for forgiveness, a way for reconciliation between sinners and a holy God had been found. No more lambs, no more bulls, no more blood. But the blood of the Lamb of God had been shed and the price was paid and the way was made. And there's a fountain for sin and uncleanness. And oh, that we could come and confess our sins and know that they're washed away in the blood of Jesus. It pleased the Father that a Savior was found. Verse 5 of Isaiah 53 says, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was wounded for our deliberate breaking of God's law and sin. And for our iniquity, that bentness and pervertedness that made us sin. You know, you never have to teach a child to sin, do you? And rebel and be awkward and be moody and say wrong things and tell lies and use bad words. You don't have to teach them all of that stuff. It comes out. But Jesus died to deal with it all. That's why it says it pleased the Father. A sacrifice was found, there was no other. Salvation has been purchased and paid. And salvation is offered to you and me and to the whole human race. It pleased the Father. A Savior had paid the price, the punishment necessary for our peace. He paid it. Well, what kind of day is it for you or me? Is Good Friday a good day? Or is Good Friday a bad day? That's why I said at the beginning, sometimes when you come to a day like this and you think about the Lord dying, there's a sadness in your heart. And then when you think that He died for your sins and forgive you, there's a gladness in your heart. And it's one of those days of, you could say, mixed feelings or emotions. But in the depths of your heart, what do you think about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ? I'll tell you what. Your response to it will tell you more what you think than our words. So, if you think Good Friday was a great day when Jesus died, then you will have responded to that by trusting Him as your Savior. You'll say, this was sad, but this was a great day. Christ died for me. I want you to be my Savior. And you'll trust Him, and you'll give yourself to Him, and you'll worship Him, and there'll be worship at this moment in your heart for Him. But if you think it's a day that's not important, or it seems like a sad day, why did a good man die? Then your response will be, well, that doesn't really matter to me. It makes no difference to me. And your response will be a bit like the religious leaders and those at Jesus' time. They despised Him. They rejected Him, and He's of no value. It's just like any other day to you. What kind of a day is Good Friday to you? In fact, this day has turned out to be one of the best days, the most important days, the greatest days in the history of the whole world. The day Christ died and paid the price for sin, for your sin and mine. Oh, it's a great day. It's a good day. What about you? What's your response? At some time in the past, you've heard about Jesus. You've trusted Him as your Savior. And this evening, Good Friday's a great day. You rejoice that a Savior was found. Or you've heard about it many times and you're hearing it again and you say, well, it's very interesting. But it's nothing to me. It's nothing to me. I don't value it. When I look at it and I weigh it up, it's of no value. It means nothing. I'll just get on my life. Well, you can never sit on the fence about the death of Jesus. You've already made a decision in your heart and in your mind. But can I encourage you, urge you? There was no other good enough to pay the price of sin. He only could unlock the gate of heaven and let us in. And in Good Friday, He only who could do it, did it. And He only who could do it offers to you and I salvation and forgiveness. But He doesn't force it on us. He offers it, invites us, tells us it's finished. There's no religion like that in the world. Every other religion you can pick tells you to do something. Jesus says, it's finished. I've done it. Just accept it. Good Friday. What does it mean to you? A good day? Rejoicing in what Jesus did? Or like any other day? It means nothing to me. I urge you. Think about it. And take Jesus as your Savior. there is no other. Let's pray, and then we're going to sing, and then tea. Father, I thank you that you so loved us, that you sent your Son, the only one who could pay the price of sin and set us free. And I thank you for Good Friday when we remember that Jesus died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Father, we value this day. We worship you for this day. We thank you for this day. We thank you for Jesus' death upon the cross. We thank you for telling us about it. Lord, when we who believe in you weigh it up, we esteem it the greatest days of all days. And we thank you for dying for us. Father, I pray that every single person in this church building this evening will rejoice on this great day and know that a Savior was given who died for their sins, if they will but trust him. Bless us in the rest of this day. Bless us over this weekend. Oh, Lord, we pray you'll bring us together rejoicing on Sunday morning in all that Jesus did for us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing our final hymn. We'll know it really well. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. Let's stand and sing this lovely old hymn together, please. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you again that you so loved us that you gave your Son. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you so loved us that you were wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement, punishment necessary for our peace, and by your stripes we are healed. We thank you, Lord Jesus, you could say upon the cross, it is finished, it's paid, it's accomplished and done. And we just thank you for such a wonderful, wonderful salvation offered freely, freely to us all. Thank you. Thank you that the blood has been shed. Thank you, a Savior has been found. And we praise you tonight, Lord, we praise you. And I pray again that each person leaving here tonight will know you, Lord, as their Savior. Draw them unto yourself. Thank you, Lord, for the good things you've provided for us. The cup of tea, the food to eat, the conversation, fellowship with one another. Thank you, Lord, for these blessings. Bless our time together and give us safe journeys home afterwards. We just give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you again for coming. Thank you to Brittany and Betty for all that they've done. Please wait with us for a cup of tea, and thanks again to all those who've put work into that. God bless you.